Welcome to our worship here on this first Sunday of 2021. It's good to be together to worship on this first Sunday in the strength and power of our Lord. A chapter in Scripture that grounds me often, especially at transition moments of life, is Isaiah chapter 40. And we'll read the closing verses of that chapter as our call to worship this morning, where we read, "Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." And it's our prayer that as we head into this year, that we will be those people who hope in the Lord and follow as Isaiah declares. Please join me in a prayer. Lord, as we enter into worship, we are thankful that you are on the throne and we are not. And we are here as a people longing for you, hoping in you, needing to find our strength in you. And we pray for that miracle of your power in and through us again as we worship this day. We pray in that strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And people of God, as we gather together, we don't do it as people just by ourselves, wherever we may be this morning. We are doing it in the presence of our God, who is present wherever we are gathered in his name. And so we can declare with confidence this morning that grace and peace be to you from God the Father and Jesus the Son, through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit within and among us. Amen. And we'll sing about that together. Lord, from sorrows deep I call, as we begin this year of Sunday worship together. powerful confession, "You're my God, you're my salvation," reminding us as we continue in worship that we come to the throne of a holy God who redeems us and cleanses us. And we come to a place of peace, a God whose love is beyond width and length and breadth and depth of our understanding. And with that in our minds, please join me in a prayer of confession. Dear Lord, we come to you as your redeemed sinners. Yes, you've begun a good work in us, as Paul declares, and we long for you, as Paul continues to say, to bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus. And so we bring to you our need for forgiveness, for salvation, for cleansing, eager, Lord, to have that Spirit that is at work in us bear the fullness of its fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Lord, take the love that you've begun to grow in us, our love for you and for each other. Heal it, strengthen it, make it more sturdy, Lord, that we may be witnesses to you of your power in us. We need you, Lord, and we bring this prayer to you in Jesus' name. Amen. We are thankful for the witness of David, who knew the power of forgiveness, as he declares in Psalm 32, "I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." And then he continues, the Lord says to him, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you." During the Last Supper, Jesus told his disciples that his way was the way of love. And Paul gives some specifics what that looks like when he says to us in 1 Corinthians 13, "Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love never fails." That's the call that comes to us again, an old call for a new year. And as God's children longing to embody his powerful love, we invite him to take our hand. Precious Lord, take my hand as he walks with us into this new year.
Take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. Shall we bow our heads in a congregational prayer? Almighty God and Heavenly Father, we bow our heads before you on this first Sunday of 2021 to thank you. To thank you for the blessings in a year gone by, a year gone by where the normalcy of life was transformed, a year where a child's birth was made a somewhat solitary event for a family, where grandparents were isolated from the outside world, where the population was forced to wear masks and where smiles were seldom seen because of them, where grocery shopping became the only excursion made throughout a week. Kids were learning online and then learning in school, but had to keep in small groups. This new normal is challenging for most. Dear God, we know through this all that you are unchanging. In all this, you are still the God that is there to calm our anxiety. You are there to lift us up when we are lonely and feeling isolated. You are there to bring hope where hope seems to be lost. We have your word, the Bible, to direct us in all aspects of life. Even now in the midst of COVID-19, we thank you for your word. We thank you that in it we may find the peace, joy, and happiness that only you can give. COVID-19, a pandemic that has caused turmoil around the globe, a disease that has caused serious illness and even death, a pandemic that has challenged many in the past months and will continue to challenge people in the coming months. And in it, we thank you. We thank you, God, for medicine and the miracle of medicine. We thank you for the vaccine that has been produced and pray that it may eradicate the COVID-19 virus swiftly. We pray for the government as they make the decisions on how to disperse it. In all this, dear Father, we as Christians are thankful. We are thankful for our health. We are thankful for our community. We are thank you that you are always present, even when we are ignorant. Father, you have the world in your hands. You control the minutes, hours, days, and years. You control the seasons and the rising and setting of the sun. We thank you for breath. We thank you for life. We thank you for our homes, for the warmth and comfort that they provide. We thank you for family and friends and for the church. We pray for our church family. We pray for those who are isolated because of the pandemic. We pray for those feeling anxiety and for those who are depressed. May they feel your nearness. We pray for those in hospital and those that are ill. Will you bless them this time as well? We pray for those who have been affected financially in the past months, whether from layoffs or from closing businesses. May those in our community who are able be there to help where help is needed. We pray for university students. School for many is not in a building, but in their own homes, in front of a laptop or computer. Online schooling can be challenging as it is hard to concentrate and focus. We pray that you will give students patience and endurance in the coming months. We pray for our young children. Everything is different, and they maybe don't quite understand why. Will you bless them as they grow and learn? Be near the parents that they minister to their children. We pray especially for the hearts of our children, young adults and adults. May you work mightily in us that we may be a shining light to those around us. We pray that we may all be bold in proclaiming you as Lord of all. We pray that your church may come out of this stronger. We may voice together in a loud voice our hallelujahs to you, the triune God, the giver of life, the almighty God who controls all. We are now worshiping remotely. We are sitting in our living rooms as individuals or as families to pray, to sing, and to hear your word. We thank you for technology. We thank you that even though we are unable to worship in a building together, we are still able to worship as your church, as a body of believers. We pray that each one of us, as we sit in front of this screen to watch, to listen, and to sing, may feel the Holy Spirit moving in us, that we may all grow a little bit more, that we may be strengthened and rejuvenated, that we may go out in the coming week knowing that you are God and it is you that carries us through the storms of life. We thank you, dear Father, that Sid Hielma could lead us in worship today. Bless him as he brings your word and bless all those who are listening. Bless us now in this moment. May we put aside the worries of last week and the worries of the week ahead so that we may meditate totally on your word as it is being proclaimed to us this morning. We above all thank you for your Son, for Jesus, who came into this world a baby, lived among us and died for us on a cross. Not only that, your Son, Jesus Christ, descended into hell to go through the ultimate pain, and who, after all that, conquered sin and death and rose to sit at the right hand of his Father to intercede for us. Forgive us our sins and keep us from sin. Bless us now in this hour. To you we give all the praise and glory. In Jesus, your Son's name we pray. Amen. We now sing Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Scripture today is Psalm 46, a much beloved psalm in the history of the church. And before we read it together, please join me in a prayer for the illumination of the Lord's Spirit as we read and reflect. Dear Lord, you have guided your flock through the power of your word and spirit. For millennia, and on this first Sunday of 2021, we long for that guidance again. We need it, and we're grateful for your provision. As we read the ancient words of Psalm 46, Lord, help us to live into them afresh and anew, and to find the miracle of your nourishment through these words for the coming year. Thank you for providing. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Dear brothers and sisters in our Lord Jesus, what does chaos look like for you? Chaos is like a sense when nothing in life seems to hold firm, when the familiar and expected aren't where they're supposed to be, when it feels like we don't have a strong foundation under our feet. I think my first experience of chaos as a child in the late 50s came when I became very personally aware of the nuclear arms race then between the U.S. and the Soviet Union, as it was called back then. And in kindergarten, we had nuclear air raid drills, which seem pretty silly today. But there we were in terms of when certain sirens went off in the community, we all had to get under our desks. And I imagine as a five-year-old picturing mushroom clouds like I'd seen in some pictures and books. And it felt to me like terror and chaos. Another experience, a little more recent, that some of you may remember as well, was about 20 years ago, September 11, 2001. At the time, I was teaching at Dort University in Iowa. And on that day, I was the scheduled chapel speaker. And about an hour before chapel, I learned of the Twin Towers having collapsed in New York City and the Pentagon being hit by a plane that crashed into it and other such things. And I knew that the chapel speech I had prepared had to be set aside, and in the space of that hour before chapel began that morning, I was drawn to Psalm 46 and delivered a reflection that morning, again, of the Lord's refuge, providing a refuge and being a firm foundation during a time of chaos. And as now we have a new Sunday beginning this new year, 2021, I feel like we've just completed a year of probably unprecedented chaos for most of us. And we begin the new year with a sense that the chaos continues. But at the same time, now we see some signs of tangible hope through the beginnings of vaccinations. As a matter of fact, one of my sons, who works in the COVID ICU in Wisconsin, was just vaccinated a couple days ago, as the health workers in that state were among the first to receive vaccinations. But what's happening here is deeper than simply getting vaccinated against a pandemic. We recognize that some of the foundations, the things that we have seen as things that we could count on and were sure in our lives, have been shaken, and we've had to do major, one of the words of the year was pivots, to adjust to the new realities, and have had all kinds of uncertainty shaping our lives day by day. And into this chaos, the ancient words of the psalm speak afresh and speak powerfully. The psalm is like a conversation of sorts between the Lord Almighty and chaos. And just to declare to us, the psalm begins by telling us how the conversation ends. It's like knowing the score of a hockey game before it begins, and then you can kind of watch the game knowing where it's going to end up, so to speak. The psalm begins by declaring, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. And we have a picture here of the creation in chaos. It's like everything around us doesn't make sense. It's all in upheaval. Think for a moment of one of the most chaotic days or times in your life. Perhaps it was the tragic death of a loved one. Perhaps it was a shocking end to a relationship that you thought was solid and firm. Perhaps it was a diagnosis that you received or a loved one received. And relive that moment for a minute and remember how the whole world seemed upside down. It was like this element of chaos turned everything on its head, and nothing made sense anymore. And the psalm begins by recognizing what chaos does to us, but declaring from its first verse, don't forget, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. One of the characteristics of chaos is that at the moment when it's at its height, it is all we can see, and it blinds us to everything else. And that's why the psalmist here pictures chaos as the entire creation in disarray, but begins by declaring, look, for this moment, it's all you can see. But remember, reality is a lot more than your eyes can see. And our starting point is reality is simply this: God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Then the psalm begins by giving us a wonderful contrast. In verse 3, we hear the waters of the sea roaring and foaming, the chaos of the sea. And some of you may know that the ancient Israelites were not seafarers. They were afraid of the ocean. And so they could resonate with this image of the ocean as a place of chaos. But to calm those troubled hearts, the psalm continues, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. It's like we get a hint of Psalm 23 here. The Lord is my shepherd. He leads me beside quiet waters. In contrast to the raging sea, we picture rivers with gentle streams as a place where the city of God is. And there's kind of an irony here. God, the Lord of the universe, the God who flung galaxies into being by the words of his mouth, says, but you know what? Those seas that terrorize you, picture me as a gentle river, a healing river, a nourishing river who calms you, who waters your lands and takes care of your own thirsts and gives you a place of peace to rest beside. And as we sit by those gentle rivers, the Lord gradually brings the chaos into focus. It began with mountains falling into the sea and the earth giving away. But now it becomes a little clearer. And now in verse 6, we read, nations are in uproar and kingdoms fall. And so it has narrowed down from creation to kingdoms. Still significantly powerful, but not as chaotic as at the beginning of the psalm. And then we get this chorus, the Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. A theme in Scripture. I might invite you to make this a part of your devotional life for 2021, is that Scriptures often describe God in two fundamentally different but beautifully compatible ways. He's the sovereign king, the Lord of the universe, the one who did fling the galaxies into being. He's the covenant God of Jacob, the one who walks with us, who knows us by name, who holds us as our name written in the palm of his hand. It's like his right hand holds the entire universe in its grip. His left hand holds onto us and calls us by our name. And that combination of almighty power, the covenantal God of Jacob, is a theme throughout the entire Scriptures. And the psalmist brings it to us here too as a way of saying, remember who your God is. He is more powerful than the chaos, and he holds you by the hand as you walk through the chaos. The psalm continues by focusing on what the Lord does, this God who is for us. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. What are kingdoms known for? For their military prowess, for their ability to conquer others and subjugate them. Who is this Lord who with his right hand holds the galaxies and his left hand walks beside us? He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. During that hour that I was preparing a meditation on 9/11 20 years ago, I was struck by how afraid I was and how weak I felt as one called to bring the word an hour after hearing about incredibly shattering news. And one thing that struck me was that here I was a Canadian living in the United States, the greatest military power on earth. And what struck me was the paradox that this immense military power had been terrorized by 19 hijackers using four planes. And I realized then that there was something in me that had thought it could trust in the military might of a powerful nation, which was the nation where I and my family lived. And I was brought to my knees to say, Lord, I want to trust in you with all my heart. I want to be a Proverbs 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding kind of a guy. But this last hour has revealed to me that part of me was trusting in military might. And this Lord of the chaos, the Lord of the kingdoms, is also a Lord who breaks the weapons of those kingdoms. And here's a beautiful theme in this psalm. He breaks them by the power of his word. You may know that Martin Luther's hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, is based on Psalm 46. And one beautiful line from his hymn is, and one little word shall fell him, shall fell the evil one. And after declaring that this Lord breaks the weapons of the kingdoms who seek to create havoc and chaos, the Lord continues, be still, enough already, quit all the noise, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Kingdoms pretend to exalt themselves and demand the exaltation from others for them. And now the Lord says, chaos is nothing. Human power and might, do not put your strength in horses, the psalmist says elsewhere. The Lord is on the throne. Do you ever feel like there's a lot of noise in your mind and heart? I can tell you, 2020 certainly created a lot of noise in my mind and in my heart. All of our children live in the United States. Our grandson lives there. There we were, cut off by a border because of the pandemic. a son working in the COVID ICU, and all kinds of noise and fear. And I hear the Lord saying to me, Sid, be still. COVID is not on the throne. Kingdoms are not on the throne. The Lord Almighty is on the throne. The one who is your fortress is also the one who declares, I am your only comfort in life and in death. Did you know that the words fortress and comfort are versions of the same word? Both derived from the word fort, meaning strength. He is our only comfort, our fortress in life and in death. And the psalm ends by going back to that refrain a little bit earlier in the psalm. Remember the right hand and the left hand of God. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Children of this King, sons and daughters of this covenant God of Jacob, how are you navigating your way into 2021? How has the chaos of this past year, both the global chaos, the national chaos, perhaps your own personal and family chaos, what does it look like to you? How does Psalm 46 help you to come to that throne so that you can say with the psalmists, therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. I invite you, especially when the noise in your heart and mind is so loud and cacophonous, a beautiful word that just describes jumbled noise, I invite you to seek the Lord's stillness, to sit in silence before his throne, to remember again who he is, and in that remembering, allow his strength to be made perfect in our weakness as we follow him. Please pray with me. Lord, we confess that it's very easy for us to be overcome by chaos. Thank you, Lord, that you are on the throne. Thank you that though the wrong seem great and strong, you are the ruler yet. Teach us, Lord, to be silent in your presence and to surrender to you the noise within us personally, within our homes, within our church community, at our workplaces. Yes, we do recognize how much uncertainty there is. But Lord, there's always more uncertainty than we realize. We are called to trust in you with all our heart and lean not on our own understanding. And we've learned that in fresh ways in this weird season. So Lord, strengthen our weak knees and our trembling hands. We want to love you and trust you and follow you. So we surrender our lives again to you, the God who is our fortress and our refuge, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And we'll sing a song that gives a New Testament perspective on the beauty of Psalm 46. Christ is mine forevermore.
Thank you.
Please join me in a prayer of thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, for that wonderful hymn that reminds us through music that our only comfort in life and death is through Jesus Christ, our faithful Lord and Savior. Thank you that we can enter into this year of worship on this first Sunday, being reminded of your faithfulness again that guides us. As we continue on our way, Lord, we are grateful for the reception of your blessing as well, the promise that you are with us wherever we go. And so we give our prayer of thanks to you in that strong and powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And once again, ancient words bless us as we come to the conclusion of our worship. Sons and daughters of the King, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and fill you with his peace. Amen.